Right now, I want to play the clip from the Fox News debate with GOP candidates where Newt and Juan Williams had a little tete-a-tete over the issue of code words. Check this out.
Speaker Gingrich, you recently said black Americans should demand jobs, not food stamps. You also said poor kids lack a strong work ethic and proposed having them work as janitors in their schools. Can't you see that this is viewed at a minimum as insulting to all Americans, but particularly to black Americans?
No, I don't see that. New York City pays their janitors an absurd amount of money because of the union. You could take one janitor and hire 30-some kids to work in the school for the price of one janitor, and those 30 kids would be a lot less likely to drop out. They would actually have money in their pocket. They'd learn to show up for work. They'd be getting money, which is a good thing if you're poor. Only the elites despise earning money.
But Governor,
it is hilarious as you watch Newt try to spin that whole deal, when the fact of the matter is he was using coded language. He was speaking directly to white voters, basically saying, I'm going to tell these no-working poor black folks to get off their behind and get to work.
And that comes on the trail of him saying that basically the only work that young people know about is illegal, when all of us have worked since we've been kids, too. Look, this whole thing, you see a pattern here. Newt tried to redefine the question, redefine the issue, and not talk about the issue. That's why, for example, he's talking about his ex-wife. Well, that was the news. She hadn't talked all these years. So you don't blame the news media because she decided to talk at this point. He's just trying to get off course. Of course he used
But I love
words.
How
they
folks
all do
start
it.
Trying to explain away. No, this is what he really meant. No, we heard what he said.
Roland, first of all, it wasn't code language. He's a modern-day Bull Connor just dressed up in a suit, and his hose is his mouth. I mean, I'm just sorry. And Newt says the most outrageous things because the raw meat that this Republican Party needs, South Carolina last night, at the debate before that, they want him to put folks in their place, particularly black folks. And I say this as someone who was a Republican for 20 years and just got tired of it. Moderates don't exist like me anymore. And the point is that Newt is playing to an audience that wants Barack Obama checked. They want him checked.
Yeah, I mean, I think I agree with Sophia. There's no way that this is coded language. He was very specific about talking about black people demanding jobs, not food stamps. And even in his past defense of the children working as janitors at their schools idea, he's used African-American youth as a specific example. So I think it's a very clear employment of the Southern strategy.
First of all, let me point out something. One. Do you know how much it costs to live in New York City? Most of us do. And I can guarantee you, on a janitor's salary in New York City, you're not living extraordinarily high on the hog. So, you know, that was a deflection.
You don't have a $500,000 credit line.
So you talk about giving a daddy or a mama, make them unemployed and hire the children to work in whatever the capacity is. So we know how ridiculous it is. Finally, this is not new, y'all. George and I are old enough and experienced enough, you have babies here, to remember during the Reagan administration, the woman in the Lincoln with the fur coat who was on welfare and bought potato chips and cognac with food stamps. Now, when I say that, I can guarantee you a white blonde woman is not the image that most of America has.
That's right.
And I say for the record, the person supposedly had 84 aliases and took government money and all of it, and he found out that never existed.
And it was interesting. Wow. Because then you have the constant referral of President Obama as the welfare president or the food stamp president, when if you look at the data, again, facts really be damned.
70%.
Bottom line is the number of whites on food stamps, but also how many folks got on under President Bush as opposed to President Obama.
And more important, with an economy like this, people needing help, they should be on food stamps and any other kind of help they can get.
Yeah, I mean, that's the point. And then the Republicans talk about the cutting. You know, it's the deficit issue and the cutting. They want to throw people off of social programs. So what? People are barely, 40 million Americans are on food stamps in this country. What are we going to throw them off?
Not black folks.
Yeah, that's
Americans.
Right. And it's disproportionately black. We won't argue that point. But the point is that what are we going to do? Throw people off the food stamps so that they're hungry and they're just dying in the streets?
Now, here's what's interesting to me, because what all of a sudden Newt begins to make these coded, these very direct comments that get white audiences excited, all of a sudden Mitt Romney is now in a position where not necessarily the inevitable candidate. And he now has to deal with that. And so he also now has to deal with the whole issue of his wealth. I want to play this clip, but then I want to come back to you and say, can Mitt Romney really appeal to those blue-collar workers and somehow convince them that he's a better person to run the economy than President Obama? Here's what he had to say.
Closer to the 15% rate, my income comes overwhelmingly from investments made in the past rather than ordinary income. I got a little bit of income from my book, but I gave that all away. And then I get speaker's fees from time to time, but not very much.
Okay. $374,000 in speaking fees.
That's what George gets.
Now, last I checked, if you are an average American with a salary of about 50 grand, you would love not very much in speaking fees. Can this man really go out to Ohio, Pennsylvania, Virginia, to go to Florida, go to these places where people have been laid off, white folks, black folks, Hispanic, you name it, and try to say, oh yeah, I'm going to look out for you?
Well, the $50,000 for family, so he's not even just
right.
an individual. Now, the thing about it is, look, this is the deal. The deal is they hate Romney, but they hate Obama more. So it's not going to be about, as you said, the facts. That's the first concern about
it. I want to add something else that is the elephant in the room, and that is his religion. Yep. And I'm going to tell you why I'm adding this. No commentator, maybe with a couple exceptions, has asked him, has Mormonism put racism behind? And asked him directly about the history, the way they took President Obama on about Reverend Jeremiah Wright. If it is fair to go after Jeremiah Wright, who's a Christian, and not address the history of Mormonism and race in this country, then they are playing a hypocritical game too. So it's not just his finances. I think that commentators and reporters better do to him, Romney, and his religion. Let's put the debate on the table, because quite candidly, the reason they don't like Romney in the Bible Belt is because they believe Mormonism is a cult.
They do. Well, I think Mitt Romney clearly has an image problem on multiple levels, but I don't think it's just on the basis of him being a wealthy businessman. As he's trying to say that people are envious of him or angry that he's wealthy, but I think it's just that he so narrowly defines himself as a business person that there's nothing else for people to connect to, and he doesn't know how to speak about himself in a way that goes beyond that.
Now, speaking of, look, we always need a good laugh. Mitt Romney rarely laughs. He's more like he's wooden. He reminds me so much of Al Gore in 1990 and 2000, and of course, John Kerry in 2004. But I have to show this little exchange on Fox News when some people really should not talk about rap music. If you have no idea who the hell you're talking about, roll the tape.
The first thing I say is that here is a picture, Bill, of Ice-T, one of the iconic figures in black culture and music. Spending
that's
a
Ice
weekday
Cube.
With,
that's not Ice-T. It's no, Ice Cube.
No. That's Ice-T.
You, no, so you it's Ice Cube, that. Bernie. That's how white you are. You don't know Ice-T from Ice Cube. That's Ice Cube.
Oh, Ice Cube. Ice Cube. Ice Cube. You're right. That's
yeah,
right. I'm sorry.
A brother,
I meant
man.
To, I'm,
you can't be doing that
meant,
to me. I know the Cubes
I meant
from
to
the
say
beats.
That.
So Bill goes to Sylvia's once a year with Reverend Sharpton. Now he's a brother.
Well, you know, cube
well,
goes into
cube
tea. That's
cube,
all you have to think it? About. I mean, just common sense. A cube goes in, you know, Ice Cube goes into iced tea.
Right.
He could have handled that.
That's
one.
What he said.
Yes, he's a brother from another planet.
Both of y'all shut the hell up.
Yeah, really. That's the bottom line.
All right, but before I let my panel go, we got to give a shout out, folks. George Curry is a part of a media group. They have acquired a Heart and Soul magazine. George, first of all, the name of the group?
Actually, it's Brown, Curry, Dietrich, Taylor Associates.
Okay, and of course, they have acquired the assets of Heart and Soul. You guys are going to publish how many issues a year?
We still do six, but we're going to actually beef up the digital portion of it.
All right, then. Well, congratulations on
Thank
being
you.
Our owner, George. And so we look forward to Heart and Soul.